Welcome to the finance meeting for Tuesday, May 31st. Madam Clerk, item number one. Counselor Stanensky.
I'd like to make a motion to move number 18 to number one.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to take item 18 out of order as the first item. All those in favor? Opposed? Madam Clerk, please read item number 18.
Resolve, the mayor or his designee, the police chief, fire chief, or their designees, the chairman of the license commission or his designee, the executive director of the board of health, and the superintendent of buildings be invited to appear before a committee of the city council to discuss ongoing code enforcement activities, available staffing, as well as specific objectives for the next fiscal year. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, John Crowley, police chief, Mike Williams, fire chief, Henry Tattaglia, chairman of the license commission, Louis Tattaglia, board of health executive director, and James Casseri, superintendent of buildings.
Counselors, before you're going on this, just to let you know, I did receive a letter from Mayor Carpenter. Due to a previous commitment, he will not be here this evening. And also, Chief Crowley has sent Lieutenant LeGrice in his spot, who handles these issues. Counselor Farwell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I'd like to thank everyone who's here, if they want to come up to the microphone. Counselor Sullivan and I filed this resolve.
I'm sorry, Counselor Sullivan, didn't see your name there.
And I think one of the reasons is that we're embarking on an urban revitalization plan for the downtown area. It seems to me that we can't neglect the neighborhoods, and we certainly can't neglect the feeder roads that are going to bring people to what we hope will be a revitalized downtown. Now, I can't go back and talk about what has happened in code enforcement, and I don't want to talk about what's happening now, but I do want to go forward, because in my judgment, based on observations I've made, based on conversations I've had, we do not do as good a job on code enforcement as we should. The license commission has a role, the building department has a role, the health department has a role, police and fire have roles to play, and while we can't dictate what's done, because this is an executive branch issue, I think the council can raise awareness of the need for code enforcement and some of the issues that I think are being neglected, maybe partially because of a lack of personnel, but it's time to get serious. It's one need only ride down Warren Avenue and take a look at Warren Avenue Myrtle Street and see a business that's ongoing there and scratch your head and say, gee, what do the people who pay taxes that live on Myrtle Street think about that business at the corner? We have another business up in Council Lally's area. They went before the ZBA. They were supposed to put in some landscaping as a buffer between property lines. They told the ZBA, oh yeah, no problem. They don't do it. And of course, we do need a zoning enforcement officer. There's no doubt about it. I know Lieutenant LeGrice has an important engagement after this, and so I'd like to start with you, Lieutenant, if you could come up and what can we do better to, in just a few minutes, I know this is an open-ended question, what can we do better to enforce the laws that relate to the different codes, ordinances that we've accepted to get back on track?
I think the first thing we have to do is to try and centralize where all these licenses should be coming from. I know that you informed me earlier that there's some state statutes that might be in the way, but I don't know whether a home rule petition, like putting all of these businesses under the license commission, I think is the way to go rather than us trying to answer to several different bodies. We also need to put some teeth into some of these, whether it be creating new ordinances or through, if we were to go into the license commission, put some teeth in them. Fines, warnings, revocation of license to operate. I mean, it works with the liquor establishments, okay? It needs to work with these fly-by-night car dealerships. Currently, the new and used car licenses come under the license commission, but repair licenses and garage license, body shop license, come under the clerk's office and the city council. To be truthful, there's not enough teeth in any of those ordinances to make people comply. The clerk's office, and I don't know who's responsible for it, but we go there to do enforcement, and they have business licenses. There are no hours of operation. There are no days a week of operation. There are no number of cars that they're limited to. What would you like me to enforce? There's nothing to enforce if they're handing out these licenses. Now, some of them have it, but a lot of them do not have any stipulations. I think we have to get better at that. I think passing, if possible, an ordinance where we had the ability, if a car dealership or a repair shop is entitled to 20 cars and they got 25 cars, we call five wreckers down and we tow them off the property. When they start paying $200 for each one of those cars to get them back, they're gonna start to comply. But right now we go down, we tell them they're over, you know, and then 3 days later they'll come back and they might be under. 2 days after that, they're back over again. They take the cars, they move them around, and we don't track every single vehicle in the city. Another thing we have to do, whoever's issuing these garage licenses, we gave two licenses to the same building on 64 Elliott Street. So can someone tell me where there's parking on Elliott Street? We run into the railroad, they park at the railroad. I've done a lot of research on that. The railroad owns that property. Until they post it, no trespassing, or want us to enforce it, there's really nothing I can do except for a 72-hour tag, which we will do, but the car's gone within 72 hours and they replace it with a second car. I've talked to them at length and they're better at it, but we're giving licenses out, I guess like candy, where we're not doing enough research to find out, do they have the parking for these cars? You know, these are some of the things that we run into with the garages. And that's really what you're talking about, Mr. Farwell, is these garages that are popping up all over the place. They're leaving car parts outside. We need to be able to say to them, you're not operating until you clean this up, okay? I'm sure the fire department will agree with you, me. We have spray booths throughout the city in body shops that are being operated all hours of the day and night that don't meet any of the fire codes, okay? We need to be able to shut these businesses down. I think ordinances, centralized, a clearinghouse for all these people to go through is probably the biggest start. I agree with you that the city needs to be cleaned up. I'm talking about unregistered cars in yards, anything, quality of life issues. That's where you have to start if you're going to start a revitalization, in my opinion.
Now, I asked you before the meeting convened, do we have the right to issue non-criminal citations for certain code violations?
Yes, we do. And those are, unfortunately, we don't have clear guidelines as to what the fines are. The only fine that I actually have, and this rests with city ordinances, to set up some type of system where, you know, operating after hours, this is the fine. We do have operating without a business license is $360 a day. That gets appealed to the clerk's office at district court. I honestly don't know how many of those we actually win, but I assume we might get a few. But I really think that if all of this was centralized through the license commission, now we have the ability to close a business down. Not that we want to do that, but I'm telling you, it'll make people comply when they can't operate for 3 days or 4 days. It'll start to make them clean up their yards and comply. We need something with some teeth in it.
All right, well, the last thing that I'll say to you is that I don't care if it's my next door neighbor, I don't care if it's my best friend, I don't care if it's a campaign donor. If you don't follow the ordinances, the only fair and equitable thing to do is to enforce them. This business about, I had one officer tell me that he went somewhere, and I'm not blaming the mayor for this in any way, but he mentioned to him having too many cars, and he said, well, call Bill. And the officer said, Bill who? He said, call Bill Carpenter, the mayor. He says I can do whatever I want. People drop names, and they get away with it. And I think that's pure nonsense. And I think that if we want a quality of life in this city, then the license commission, the police department, the fire department, the building department, the health department, we've all got to be pulling in the same direction. We've got to be fair and equitable. And I'm talking about first education. I don't want to drop the hammer on people. You know, take a period of time when you have maybe 60 or 90 days and go out and educate people and say, look, on and after this date, you're going to be held accountable.
We've done that, Councilor Fowle. We have actually, as the police department, have done that throughout the city. We have visited almost every, I finally got a list of every single repair garage. You think every class 2 license, every class 1 license, new cars and used cars, every liquor establishment, every liquor store, every restaurant that sells alcohol, that all comes under us, okay? That's a lot there. We've visited almost everybody, and now the second and third time through, we're starting to write citations. We've given everybody, I think, plenty of time to come within compliance, and I'm sure you're going to start to get some calls because we're starting to issue these things now.
I'm sure you can see, sitting here, and I've only been here for 4.5 months, but not one person brought in regarding a violation of a garage license, not one warning issue, not one hearing. I mean, there's got to be, in a city this size, someone out there who's got some egregious violations. And I guess at this point, I'd like to ask Mr. Tattaglia, Mr. Louis Tattaglia, Mr. Casseri, Chief Williams, what can we do better? And just briefly come up and tell us, what can we do better? And maybe as a group, we can push the executive branch to get serious on code enforcement.
It's very simple, Councilor. And I think the mayor will be introducing it to the council pretty soon. And he will be speaking about it in his, I guess, when he comes up for his budget. And that's to accept Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 40U, where unpaid fines can be placed on liens on the property. That's the same as if you had an unpaid water bill or an unpaid tax bill. You have to hire a hearing officer, and there's a process for it. That's Chapter 40U of the Massachusetts General Laws. I mean, as far as what we do, I mean, we've been enforcing quite a few of the ordinances. As you may look only around the city, there's probably no graffiti. 99% of the graffiti in the last year has been removed. And we were fortunate to get CDBG funds, thanks to the mayor and Robert Jenkins. And hopefully we'll get that money for my code enforcement officers, ordinance enforcement officers, this coming fiscal year. The mayor said he will try to find the money if we don't get it from the BRA. And we've been enforcing the vacant and abandoned properties, buildings. There's a list of those. Just go on the computer. All you have to do is put that, whatever street it is, and that'll tell you how many of the, what houses are vacant on that street. There is a revolving fund also to take care of some of these properties. And it's like the one down on the corner of West Chestnut and Warren Avenue. And it's a boarded up cape that's been boarded up for 2 or 3 years. There's a fence around it, and it was all overgrown. I sent the code enforcement down there, take pictures, and Ernie Bethany and his group went there, cleaned it, and I told them to go back there because the fence was all broken. I want that whole fence ripped out and replaced. Any work that they do, we place a lien on that property for the work we do.
Okay. Mr. Casseri, illegal apartments, issues of public safety there. And I guess the first question I'd ask is, if we're doing a revaluation, will you get information from the assessors if suddenly we find out a single-family home has turned into a three-family and there's no building permits? Or is there that cross-communication that can help?
Well, everything that all of our permitting, if it's a new house or an addition, goes to the, they get a copy of that permit down in the assessor's office so the property can be assessed. As far as the Louis was talking about the fines being lienable, that's one thing I was going to mention, is that we could, right now you can write all the fines you want. If they don't pay them, you can't lien. So that is a very good point Louis brought up. And with the illegal apartments, Counselor, we're almost out straight on those at any given time. This week I don't have one yet, but the week is young, so we find them. Depending upon what zone they're in, if it's an R1, everything's got to go. Everything unpermitted has to be able to be inspected. So when we find an illegal apartment, they have to allow us entry. They have to hire a licensed contractor, licensed plumber, licensed electrician, open up all the walls so we can do inspections if it's allowed in that zone. There's a lot to it when we find an illegal apartment, particularly one, there's like 19 of them in one home, like we have over on Mystic Street, we had. We're dealing with that one now. And then there's a, and it's so much work for the law department. We keep the law department very busy, just my department alone. I can't even speak to the other departments here, how often they use them. So there's a lot going on, and there's a lot of people, teams at play here. I will say the couple of good things have happened. I know you said you didn't want to talk about what has already happened, but the C-Click fix has been fantastic. Immediately, the proper department can respond to a situation, whether it's a house without a permit, or if there's trash in the yard, or unregistered vehicles. And the other thing is the situational awareness. I don't know if any of the counselors are familiar with that, but all of these agencies can immediately email with one push of the button automobile crash into a certain address, and all of us get it immediately so we can all respond. So communications between the departments have really increased this year, and I look forward to that continuing.
Okay, I guess my first question though is that the people that are going out doing the reval of the city, all of the different properties, if they have a card that says this is a single family house and they find out suddenly it's a two family, will that information get pushed back to you? Not a building permit that comes into you going down to the assessors, but from the assessors upstairs to
the assessors really, they'll go out, and if there's three mailboxes on the house, they'll call it a three family. But I will never know that.
Okay.
The assessor's database doesn't jive with reality as far as what I have up in my office. My office is the one that does the legal use determinations, not the assessor's office. However, if there are three apartments in a building, they certainly should be being assessed at that. But that doesn't mean they're legal, and I don't necessarily find them out, Counselor.
Okay. Chief Williams? What can we do better, particularly where fire safety is everything?
Well, good evening. One thing I think that can be looked at is something that the city has done in the past, and they assembled a code enforcement task force. I know it was popular in the 90s and even into the 2000s, where a member of each organization, I think, got together on a monthly basis, and they went through a list of complaints and the high priorities problems that they felt were in the city. That task force traveled throughout the city on that one day of the month, and it allowed each entity to address the problem right there on the spot. In other words, a lot of times what happens is if my men on the apparatus are out and they spot a problem or a violation they feel, they're obligated to call that into either the billing department or the health department, what have you. That takes time, and I think the process is a long, windy road. But with this task force, it allowed these reports to be done on the spot. I believe even violations were written on the spot. So that may be something that we want to revisit. Fire safety, a lot of that is handled by my Fire Prevention Bureau. In fact, when this code enforcement is done, it is done through my Fire Prevention Bureau. They handle a lot of those issues.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, I'd like to yield to Councilor Sullivan, if I could.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Fowler.
Sullivan.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I've been on the council 11 years, so I have a different perception than when I will look at the past. And myself and former colleague Michelle Dubois, we were pretty vocal when there were certain personnel changes made. People were taken out of positions for whatever reason, and there definitely was a negative impact since that time. One of my big pet peeves is people using the charity drop boxes as a dumping ground. And I know Pat Sullivan's here, and I know your staff is working on that. But at the end of the day, there's an expectation to have a quality of life in the city of Brockton. And I do applaud you, Chief. I think the task force idea is should be brought back. And I am troubled, and thank you for being here, Lieutenant. I'm troubled the fact that conditions that are placed, and again, 11 years on the council, I don't remember too many ward councils not putting stipulations on licenses. And if they're not being shown up, there's a disconnect, and it needs to be addressed quickly. Because again, a license, it's not a right, it's a privilege. And we're not naive to the fact is blatant violations of conditions, blatant disregard for ZBA decisions that have conditions attached. And we need to have some type of collaborative approach. And again, I know when things were done a certain way, some people's feathers were ruffled and said some people are playing hardball on this business owner or that business owner. But at the end of the day, we need to make sure that, you know, we're all taxpayers, right? We all live here, we all work here. So we need to make sure that things are done the right way. And when Councilor Falwell said he was going to file this resolve, I jumped on board because I think that it's long overdue. And I know when I tried to file an ordinance change to address the charity drop boxes a few years ago, and Council, you remember that, most of the councils that were here remember this, the charities in the city of Brockton said the city council was being anti-charity, and that wasn't the intent at all. There's quality charities here in the city of Brockton that do yeoman's work to benefit the community, but you can go anywhere and see these being used as a rubbish depot. I was going by West Library today, and if you look to the right, and that's a cemetery right there, I mean, it's a dump. It's disgusting. So I think we need to figure out how we can go after. And 40U is something I'm aware of. We did it when I was attorney over in Randolph, and it took some steps to get it done, but it was pretty valid. It really used in the right way. But I think we need to figure out, and maybe a centralization, like the lieutenant said, maybe that's the way to go. But right now, what we're doing isn't working. You know, when you drive up Manamet Street and you look at the Whitman School and it's tagged, I mean, that's uncalled for, and it needs to be addressed. I mean, it looks disgusting, broken windows and people graffitied and stuff like that. So I don't really have any questions for any of you. I do applaud you for what you're doing. You know, you're doing what you can with what you have where you are right now. But we need to do better, and that's the council, and that's you, and it's everybody, and it's the mayor. And even though, as Mr. Falwell said, it's an executive decision, really it's a Brockton decision. So we need to come up with some avenues. And you know, Mr. Kasiri, if the assessors aren't reporting to you, well, maybe they should, because if somebody goes out to reevaluate and you find an illegal three-family, it should be addressed, and I don't know why it's not. But I also don't know why, when you go to the clerk's office, you don't see those conditions attached to that specific address. One thing that former counselor Jay Stewart did when he came here was he made everybody that was coming before the council have a resume attached. I think maybe we should have anybody coming for either a new license or a renewal to have a layout of the property attached. I think that might make sense. That way all 11 of us can see what the heck's going on. So it's the little things that we can do, I think, collectively to get it done. So, again, I think this was a good thing that Wynn and I put forward. And with that being said, Mr. Chairman, I'll give it back to you. Thank you.
Thank you. Councilor Beauregard.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. And I want to thank my colleagues for filing this. And could I have the lieutenant back up, please? I'm sorry. Thank you. Thank you all for being here, because this is an issue for the whole community. The reason I'm asking the lieutenant is because I spent a long time speaking with Bonnie Tucker about some situations. First of all, thank you for bringing up 64 Elliott Street. And it's a never-ending battle. And it doesn't matter what time you drive by there. It's amazing. Whether it's a Sunday morning or a Saturday evening, there's just, you know, they're just all piled up there. And that concerns me. I don't think it's fair to the neighborhood. And I realize that you've made more than one visit there. But also, what concerns me, too, is sometimes these violations that take place not 9 to 5 Monday through Friday. And how does that work for you to follow up on a violation that might be taking place at 2 o'clock in the morning?
Well, a good example is 50 Meadowbrook Road. We had after-hours parties there recently.
Oh, really?
And we, in the police department budget, there is money for enforcement, for code, for ordinance and code enforcement under licensing. Okay, we take that and use that also for code enforcement. And we'll go out at any hours. That was happening at 3-4 o'clock in the morning. We sent officers out at 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning to specifically shut that thing down and address that situation. And it was done. The last 3 weeks, it hasn't been operating. So we do have the ability to pretty much handle anything any hour of the day.
Okay, so this is regardless if it's a business that's operating in the middle of the night and it's supposed to be really operating, let's say, 7 to 4 every day, or if it's...
Council, I send licensed agents out at 6 a.m. in the morning, 5 a.m. in the morning, to go to repair shops and body shops to count the number of cars, to make sure that they're not, as they are down on East Main Street, parking on East Main Street. We tow those cars right off of East Main Street because they're on a public way and they're dismantled. So We don't put the 72-hour tags on those. We just tow those cars. And we'll also go out late at night for liquor violations for and also for repair shops to see who's operating after hours and things like that. What we really need is a clear fining system that we can start issuing more of these citations that Councilor Farwell has talked about, which I think is great. It just has to be articulated so that we're on firm ground when we write these citations.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Barnes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Actually, Lieutenant LeGrace, if I could.
Sure.
When I believe it was, yeah, you said that when you go out about the stipulations. I remember when I first got on the council, I was in awe, actually, at some of the veterans when a person would come before the council to get a garage license or some other kind of license that needs council approval. For instance, Councilor Dubois, Councilor Stewart, they would just rattle off the stipulations. You know, you have to be open at this time. You can't have this many cars, this. You can't have that. Can't have that. And they'd have nothing in front of them. And I was in awe thinking, oh, how did you know that? And they said, well, these are pretty much just general stipulations that usual businesses have when they come into the city. So particularly, I remember that Elliott Street one when they first got theirs. Councilor DiNapoli said specifically, do not have any cars across the street. That is not your property. It belongs to the railroad. Do not have any cars there. And I've gone by there as well, and the cars are on top of each other. It looks like a pileup on a highway sometimes going over there and seeing all those cars over there. And I never really knew who to talk to or who to report it to. And I have to kind of, you know, echo a little bit what my colleague Sullivan said, Councilor Sullivan, about it was easier when there was kind of one person to go to or kind of a centralized place that you can go to and say, hey, listen, this is what's going on. Currently, if I have a Board of Health issue, I call Kevin Borges. He's great. Anytime, day or night, I text him a picture. He's all over it. He reports back. He's excellent. But he's just one man, and that, you know, that he's only got one kind of issue. So when you say that the stipulations aren't there, I guess I'm trying to reconcile that, because I know that in the council, the at least the former councilors, they make sure that the people understand. And even Councilor Stewart, he's just like, do you understand even English? Do you need me to speak this in another language? Making sure that there's no language barrier so that people don't get their businesses shut down and, you know, they don't have any food and all these other kinds of things that were going on at the time. So how can the stipulations not be there when enforcement goes out, when they're so specifically told to the people here?
I believe the council has probably imposed these stipulations on many of the businesses. Okay, why they're not? Every business has to have posted in their business a business license. When we go in there, it says you're allowed 20 cars. You're allowed to operate Monday through Friday. These are hours. Saturday, no, nothing on Sunday. Mm-hmm. But many of these places we are visiting have nothing on them.
Okay, so now how do we
not
fix
all
that?
Of them? Not all of them. So for instance, 64 Elliott Street, the right side of the building there,
right,
they have stipulations on theirs. I sent somebody out there today, and he sent it to me today because I've been there several times and haven't been able to speak to the owner. They got there today. They were able to go in and inspect the license,
right,
and now we'll enforce that because we finally got to see what they have on their license. But I think what's happening is for some reason, well, they're busy, whatever, they come there, get a license, but the stipulations don't seem to consistently come from the council to the clerk's office to the piece of paper that we need to see when we go out.
So is that something that maybe we need to, that middle piece there, is there something maybe in the clerk's office that when they pick up their license or however it's issued, that needs to also be something that needs to be displayed so that when you go, you can readily see that?
I think that I mean, I don't know why the clerk's office, if they get the stipulations from the council, why they're not being put on the actual business license.
Okay, that's fair.
It's as simple as that.
Okay, that's fair.
Of information, some of those licenses may be older and predate somebody putting stipulations on there. So
That was going to be my next question. So are a lot of these places grandfathered?
Well, business license is good for 3 years, so they don't predate 3 years and they've been back. So if there aren't any stipulations on them, we should be adding them.
If they were none put on by a former council years ago, they don't have to come back before us. So
they just get renewed.
Yes.
So they get renewed in their original state without the stipulations?
If they had no stipulations originally.
Why do that?
Every licensee doesn't come before us every 3 years, Councilor.
But you're having, just the point of order, but you're having a problem or a situation
If they're in existence, yes.
Yeah.
And usually they are. It's just, I think you're going to find some of the businesses just don't put all the information up that they want to put up. So I'll let my say, but it's my turn. But
right.
Okay. Thank you. And actually, Captain Williams. Thank you, Lieutenant.
You're welcome.
Chief. Oh, I'm sorry. Chief Williams, I'm sorry. Oh. Please forgive me. Forgive me.
You're off the Christmas card list now.
Yeah, I got him on the mind here because I'm looking at my email. So the task force that you were talking about, and I'm not sure if this is the same one that you were mentioning, but I know that when Mayor Carpenter, when he was first elected, he changed one of the like home task forces that the previous administration had to the Mayor's Housing and Neighborhood Stabilization Advisory Group. And so we meet every month, and also several representatives from several agencies, and that's, you know, the mayor is on here, Nick Giaquinto, Robert Jenkins, Frank Azzaro, Patrick Lawton, Kevin Borges, Ed Williams. There are a lot of, the DA's office, a lot of people that are represented in that room, and I also attend these meetings as well. And we go out to some of these places, they identify some of these places, and that is actually through the grant that Joel Hirschman has with the Dilapidated Properties coordinator there. Mm-hmm. And there's a five-page list of all of these places that we've visited. One in particular was the corner of Warren and West Chestnut. We went in there. We went in there with the sheriff's office, and they opened the door. We took a look and all these other kinds of things. So I'm just kind of wondering, so is that what you were talking about, that we need to reinstate, or is there something?
I believe that's a different program.
Okay, so what would...
Yeah,
okay, but we're still going into these places.
Privately owned homes or private residences.
Lou, can you go to the microphone and explain that just for the people at home who will see this on, it's not on live.
I just wanted to be clear because you mentioned that one that's particular.
That's the receivership program. That's the one where you, first we get the warrants to go into the vacant property, and then there's either code, and then the police, fire,
DA's
Board
office.
Of Health, and the DA's office go into that property to ensure that you have enough, let's say, background on that property to warrant that being put into receivership. That the program that the chief is talking about is there used to be a task force. Is you have police, fire, Board of Health, electrical, plumbing, whatever agencies, and they have a list of properties that they have had complaints on that really don't fall to one department. It's better. There's so many issues that you're better off going there with all of everybody at once. That's the code enforcement program.
Okay, so you're saying that is not happening. Is that what you're saying, that has fallen?
Well, they used to have it, and it kind of evaporated in the last 3 or 4 years. It's not, they, as far as I know, they do not go out on the on that task force anymore. That was a monthly task force.
The one that, or something that dried up, or just
something the city established.
The city had established it, and there were some problems with it. And it was basically kind of dissolved on its own. It was a good program, okay. And it still could be a good program.
Okay.
I mean, we would go there. Let's say the Board of Health. And we would go onto the property, look on the outside, look at the insides of the property, have cars towed if necessary, make sure they got certificates of fitness, right down the whole line. The fire department would go there, as far in the police department. The best thing to do on some of these properties is, which you overlook sometimes, is to go in the basements of some of these properties. You wouldn't believe some of the wiring and the plumbing, it's unbelievable.
Huh, okay, all right. thank you. I hope we can revisit this, you know, when several of the other invitees are able to come also to add some. But thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Councilor Monahan.
I think she's basically covered. I was just going to ask what, because as when I first got on, that was pretty effective, the task force. That was always, I was always getting phone calls from my Council Allman, yeah, well, maybe we'll be Scott Allman or Eddie Williams all the time with properties in my area. But yeah, I was just wondering what had happened to that, and I hadn't heard about it for a while, so I hope you bring that back.
Thank you.
All right, thank you, thank you.
Thank you.
Councilors, one thing I did want to mention on the Elliott Street property. Recently, we've been having some issues with fires out in what's called mm-hmm. Tent City.
Mm.
A lot of the access to Tent City is through that area that we're talking about. It causes problems for my department if we need to get medical equipment through there. We've spoken to the owner of Banner Systems. He's on board, and he's been communicating with CSX, the railroad yard. Okay. One of the issues just that's come up tonight that we're in the process of trying to do is move that barrier. There's a big metal barrier that sits probably 15 to 20 feet off of the road. We're in the process of working with CXS to move that out closer to Elliott Street, hopefully to eliminate the problem of those cars being jammed in there.
Thank you.
I just wanted to bring that up.
Okay. Councilor Studensky.
My questions have been asked. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Councilor Razak.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Actually, through you, I wanted just to my colleagues, Councilor Farwell and Sullivan, thank you for filing this, because this is, we've had an issue with code enforcement or with our ordinances from day one since I've been on the city council. And I know we're looking for our department heads for some answers, but I really believe that the answers are with us to relook at our ordinances and reword them, make them enforceable. I had a major issue when I was, from day one when I was elected, with a huge tractor trailer in a small residential area. We had an ordinance, but no matter, it depended on who went out there to enforce it. It depended on how the ordinance was read. So we really need to relook at this. This is something that would have to be looked at individually, because each ordinance is going to be different. For example, noise and nuisance, depending on where the noise and nuisance is, you know, some can be enforced, some can't, as I found out. So the whole point of this is that we really need to look at it individually and really put the fines in there and make them enforceable, so the agents that are going out there to enforce them, they have something in hand to work with. Thank you.
Thank you, Councilor. Councilor Ianniri.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and apologize for being a few minutes late this evening, as I had to report some duty this evening at work, so that's why I came in at the time I did. I do want to take time to thank Councilor Sullivan and Councilor Fowle for filing this, and I think through you to the two councilors, I think as I read what's before me, I know Councilor Fowle wasn't here, but Councilor Sullivan was. I think this is somewhat a little bit of a follow-up of what we had just about a year or two ago, when the former Chief Hayden, and through the mayor, we lost a position. I think that's what it really comes down to, is the elimination of a position that never got filled again because some people felt we didn't need it. And I always disagreed with it, and I didn't say much about it last year because I stood at the podium, but I am gonna say a lot about it this year, and I am pleased to see that you put a paragraph in that we need to be doing something as we look at the budget for our next fiscal year, because we do need that that position. And I leave names out of that position. Everyone knows what I'm talking about. I think the loss of that position has been the loss of the cleanliness of this city, to be truthful with you. The person was not afraid to go out there and address the issues head on, no matter who we were, what color, race, or code we were. And I think that's what's sad right now, is the fact that when I drive through the city, and I drive through the city, morning, noon, at night, mm-hmm. Hank, I was there at 11:15 at the stadium and everything went well. So, I mean, there's a point that I was there at 11:15 p.m. it was. You know what I mean? So there I was. But in any case, when I drive through the city and see the situations as is, it's saddening to see that we're not taking care of our city in the way that it should be. Just this evening when I was coming, I came Warren Avenue because I wanted to check a situation I have at Myrtle Street and Warren Avenue. It's an auto body mechanic shop. I know the stipulations I put on that shop when I became counselor. I went by tonight and there's 13 to 14 cars jammed in there, just jammed in there. let alone the 25 or 30 that are in the backyard to make a new Walker's junkyard. Uncalled for. Totally uncalled for. That's why I think we as councilors, we need to be strong on this and make sure a position is put back. It's unfortunate that I wish the mayor was here this evening so that he could talk to us further about it, and the chief. I do appreciate the lieutenant for being here as the designee, but it all goes back to another former chief and the mayor at that particular time. But, you know, I get calls all the time from people that are telling me that the conditions of the city, it's in deplorable situation, and why are these things happening? Even we're even letting go. Where I've gone by and I see cars now 3, 4, 5 deep in people's yards, unregistered, and they're in the yards. We don't have enough of manpower and enforcement, and I think it's sad, and it's something we need to do. But anyhow, I'm not going to carry on with it. I just want to commend my councilors for bringing this before us this evening, and I thank everyone else that's here and has answered questions that the councilors have had. I think it's something that we seriously need to be doing as councilors. We need to be making a correction here, and we have to do it within this next budget. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. You'll get to finish. It's your ordinance, so hold on. I think Council Beauregard wanted one more question, and then you'll get to finish.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. If I could have the fire chief up here again. Thank you. The reason I'm calling you up is for two reasons. One is because I'm not sure who to call and ask about this. So because I'm afraid of fire, and people die in fire sometimes, I'm approaching you first here. When you brought up the homeless issue, and this always concerns me because I wonder, is there some way we can look at, we're not the only city with the homeless problem, and we're not the only city with a tent city within. And it just seems that you share information in your various professions throughout both the Commonwealth and probably the nation in some instances. Are there any things that we could be doing or learning from someone else or going after certain monies to begin to address this? Because some other individuals have expressed, not only is it frustrating, for you to go in there if you need to address a fire, and the summer's coming. We haven't had all the rain we were supposed to, so that always scares me because I know there's brush fires. But also, some of the individuals that, spend their time there might not be the best individuals to be near schools and homes because of our small children.
Right. Council, let me begin by saying that this obviously is a very sensitive issue in the city at this time, and I can assure you that the mayor is addressing this issue. And when I say sensitive, it's because there's many different levels where the situation is being dealt with. It's certainly not something that's been put on the back burner because there's several issues down there. There's fire safety issues. The opiate epidemic has hit that area very hard. So we're addressing, from a fire department standpoint, we're sending fire prevention through there occasionally, making sure that the people are aware that they shouldn't be cooking, lighting fires in there. It's really tough to police that aspect, though. And again, I think everyone realizes that the mayor is working very hard on the opiate epidemic, and it's that population, the homeless population in that area, that it's hit very hard. So I don't want to speak for the mayor, but I can tell you that it's being addressed and being addressed very seriously.
Okay, thank you. And my other question is, when we deal with this abandoned property, for example, both Councilor Sadinski and myself were contacted by a constituent that wasn't sure which ward they were in, and they asked because they have an abandoned property right near them, and they're concerned. And I always remember Ed Williams saying that when we had the strong foreclosure issue, we still have foreclosure problems in this city, and this must be one of them, that they were always hated it when the windows were boarded up. I mean, they do look unattractive. They said if some individuals were, making a residence in there, unwarranted, that this became a dilemma also. So I was in one.
Yeah, anytime we encounter that, we work with Commissioner Cassiri and try and make the buildings as secure as we can. I know Commissioner Cassiri's also gone to the step of painting a lot of the boarded up windows so it doesn't look so unattractive to the neighborhood. But there's aspects like that that we're looking at.
Okay, thank you very much.
You're welcome.
You all set? Councilor Rodriguez.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Chief?
Good evening.
I just wanted to, for the record, you know, that this whole task force that you were talking about existed. It was actually created during the Harrington administration.
Okay.
Because I often, because of the language issues, I had to actually go with them and translate that information to a lot of them. So I remember it was created around that time. I'm not exactly sure who started or how it started. I know it was effective during that time period. And it was about 5 or 6 members. There wasn't a great deal of individuals that actually played that role. But I wanted to make sure that I leave something here very clear, because the city of Brockton isn't dirty because of repair shops. That's one of the contributing factors, but it's not just the repair shops. We've got bazillions and gazillions of open lots all over the city collecting trash. I just drove by one on Center Street. I mean, I remember there was a whole shopping center coming to that little space where the flower shop used to be on Center Street. It's now a garbage collecting area, you know? I mean, I know that it's customary to pick on the garages and pick on the folks that are, you know, fixing cars and things like that. They're one of the problem. They're not the problem. There's a lot of other issues going on in the city, and I think one of the issues that we had with some code enforcement in the past is because it was targeting certain businesses or certain entities. And I think so as long as we continue to do the same thing, it's going to be a problem. That's when you have people come forward and complain about those specific issues. I think we need to make it so that there's some serious fines attached to the enforcement. But it's broad, and it has to be citywide. It can't just be very specific to very specific types of businesses, because the garages are not the only ones that are actually dirtying the city up. And as a matter of fact, when you look at some of these boarded up properties that we have in the city, I mean, we've got a building right down the street from us here, 47 West Elm Street. That thing has been boarded up for how many years? You know, it continues to be boarded up. I mean, it seems like, I don't want to bring it up here that, you know, it depends who owns the businesses that we are going after, but you know what? I think we need to be clear about this, that it has to be a concerted effort from this body and the city itself to enforce it throughout, so that it doesn't come across as that we're just picking on specific certain businesses and not go after the root of the problem, which is dirtiness and boarded up buildings and throughout the city. Thank you, Chief. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Councilor Farwell.
Well, just to close, if I could say to my good friend, Councilor Rodriguez, through the chair, I don't care who owns the business. If you're not compliance with the license that was issued, then we should do something about it. I don't care whether it's somebody that's been a longtime Brocktonian for 50 years or whether it's someone that just came in last week. The laws should apply to everyone equally. Likewise, we as politicians, from the mayor's office on down, should not get involved in that. Somebody calls me and says, I'm awfully sorry, I just got an enforcement action from the police department, my attitude is going to be, look, that's between you and the police department. I am not going to get involved in that as a counselor. And unless we all pull together and do that, we take politics out of the enforcement, we're never going to have the system that I think should be in place. This is a complex issue, and what I'd like to suggest to my colleagues is, let's get through the budget. I'd like to make a motion to postpone this to a FinCom meeting in August and have the people come back so we can take a look at what their budget is and what they reasonably think they can accomplish, and have the mayor here, because I think he will work with us. He may not agree with us on everything, but I do think he'll work with us on this particular issue. So my motion is to postpone to a FinCom meeting in August and to
second.
Have the parties invited back.
Motion made and seconded to postpone to the FinCom meeting in August. Councilors, just so you know, the reason we took this out of order tonight is Lieutenant LaGrace was thrown into this at the last minute. His wife is waiting for him. It's their anniversary. So we hope she's still waiting for him. All those in favor of postponement? All those opposed? Postponed to the August FinCom. Just a note on that, this was also referred to the Standing Committee on Public Safety, which may want to take this up and start to put together some recommendations. Madam Clerk, item number one.
Appointment Paul Marion as a member of the License Commission for a 3-year term ending in May 2019, replacing Scott McDuffie. Invited Paul Marion.
Good evening, Mr. Marion. Do you have anything to say?
Good evening, everybody. Oh. Nope. I'm looking forward to the responsibility of being a full-time licensed commissioner.
Move for a favorable recommendation.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? Opposed? Recommended favorably. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Good evening.
Councilor Monahan.
I'd like to make a motion to take items 2 through 13 collectively.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to take items 2 through 13 collectively. Those are all the revolving funds that are yearly have to be approved. All those in favor of taking them collectively? All those opposed? Madam Clerk, please read 2 through 13, please.
Order that pursuant to the Massachusetts General Law, Chapter 44, Section 53E1/2, the City Council authorizes the reestablishment of revolving funds for the request for public records, for the parking violation fines, the Comcast, for the Women's Commission receipts, for the Grave Linings Revolving Fund, for the Manning Pool Revolving, for the 40R Smart Grant Incentive, for the demolition of buildings, for the War Memorial Building, for the Abandoned Building Registry, the Keep Brockton Beautiful, and the last one, for the Composting Bin Distribution Program.
Councilors, if you have any questions, I think Mr. Conan can probably answer all of them. Any questions?
Make a motion for favorable recommendation.
Second.
Motion made and seconded for recommend.
Actually, on the motion, I'm sorry, Mr.
On the motion, Councilor Barnes.
Number 9, the demolition budget. So this $110,000. How does that work with the $400,000 that we approved a couple weeks ago?
It's in addition to.
I was wondering.
This is a revolving fund, so there is a deposit into the demolition fund. The balance in it now is. Let's see if I can find it.
Ow.
The $110,000 is a restriction on how much can be spent without coming back to you for additional spending authority.
Okay.
But there's a balance of $282,000 in that revolving fund. So Mr. Kasiri can spend $110,000. And then in addition to that, he could come back and get at that $282,000. And there's an annual appropriation as well in the budget, and I think that's $40,000 or $50,000.
That was earmarked for the 5 demos we talked about.
What? Where?
We had the Kresge building and then 5 houses we were going to demo, and that money was put in there then.
The list that you provided the last time when we asked? Okay.
Correct.
Okay. Yes. I just wanted to see in relation to this, to that money.
Huh? Okay. All right. So you have a revolving fund. He's authorized to spend $110,000 from that fund, and there are $282,000 in it.
Okay. Just wanted to see that. Thank you so much. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably. All those in favor? Opposed? Recommended favorably, full city council. Thank you, Mr. Conan. Item number 14.
Order that the personnel director research the salary levels for comparable positions in the school department and municipal government and prepare a report for review by the city council. Further, that this report be provided within 90 days of the date of this order unless the personnel director requests additional time. Invited Maureen Cruz, personnel director.
And I did receive communication from Maureen Cruz. She's on a previously scheduled vacation. Couldn't be here this evening, although I don't think we really need her here. Councilor Fowle?
No, Councilors, Ms. Cruz will do a salary comparison for comparable positions between school and municipal. I think you're going to find it very, very interesting. I put 90 days in the order because I know she has a number of other things to do, so I'd like to move to postpone this to
Second.
The FinCom meeting in September.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend this to the FinCom meeting in September, in which time we'll give Ms. Cruz time to do that report. All those in favor? Opposed? Recommend the Finance Committee meeting in September. Item number 15.
Order that pursuant to the provisions of the Mass General Law, Chapter 44, Section 53A, the City Council hereby authorizes the acceptance and expenditure by the Fire Department of a grant in the amount of $300 from the Harbor One Bank as set forth in the attached grant documents. Such funds are to be used for the areas of youth education and prevention by the fire education officer to assist in delivering the message of fire safety to the students of Brockton. No match is required. Invited Michael Williams, fire chief.
Chairman, I'm going to make it self-explanatory. Favorable recommendation back to full council.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to full city council. All those in favor? Opposed? Recommended favorably. Thank you, chief. Item number 16.
Order that pursuant to the provisions of the Mass General Law Chapter 44, Section 53A, the City Council hereby authorizes the acceptance and expenditure of a grant in the amount of $35,000 from the Commonwealth of Massachusetts Department of Conservation and Recreation. Such funds are to be held under the Parks and Recreation Conservation and Recreation Grant Fund to be used to improve McKinley Park. There is no match required. Invited Timothy Carpenter, Superintendent of Park and Recreation.
Good evening, Mr. Carpenter.
Good evening, councilors. This is an appropriation through the governor's budget. It'll be up to $35,000 earmarked specifically for McKinley Park. The plan at this point is to try and redo the basketball court there, which is in kind of difficult condition. It'll include removing the old pavement, repaving the new court, new hoops, new poles, new backboards, lining of the court. Depending on the condition of the subgrade and if there's any money left over, either player benches or possibly a fence down the south side of that basketball court to prevent balls from rolling into oncoming traffic.
Motion for a favorable recommendation.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably to the full city council. All those in favor? Opposed? Recommended favorably.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Carpenter. Item number 17.
Order that the City Council of the City of Brockton petitions the Great and General Court under the provisions of Section 8 of Article 89 of the Amendments to the Constitution of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts for an act as follows. An act relative to the establishment of a Bill of Rights for homeowners in the City of Brockton. Invited Ronell Remy, BTA, Marty Flax, Esquire Law Office, Emma Grigsby, City Life, and Steve Meacham, City Life.
Any of the invited guests want to step up and give a very, very brief, this is something the council has already voted on.
Right.
This is, council, in case you don't know, we've passed this in the past. This is to ask the state legislature under a home rule petition to make this law.
Councilors, if I may, I filed this, and while the members of BTA are coming forward, it is in your packet, and like Council Cruz said, this is the order that was passed by this body last year, authored by Councilor Dubois at the time. And what the members are looking to have happen is for us to move it favorably to be a recommendation for a home rule petition to our state delegation. So they're going to be very, very brief, but I would ask that you consider moving this forward to go to a home rule.
Step right up and give your name to the clerk.
Okay, my name is Emma Grigsby, and I live here in Brockton. And I work with the Bank Tenant Association as an organizer. And first of all, I want to thank you all for passing the ordinance last year in the summertime. We really appreciate it. And it has been helpful to keeping some of our members in their home after foreclosure. Meanwhile, we continue to fight foreclosure and its problems. As you all probably know, Brockton was one of the highest areas affected by this illness. And just from the last thing you all were going through, you know, that empty houses does not, vacant houses does not make good neighborhoods, all right? And just yesterday, listed in the Banker and Tradesman newspaper, were 30 listed petitions for foreclosures or auctions, and I think everybody here will agree, that's a whole lot. You know, we've heard that the foreclosure situation has come under control, but not here in Brockton. 30 petitions, just yesterday tells you that we are in trouble. We, naturally, the banks are challenging the law. One of our members, a former owner, now facing eviction by Fannie Mae, was to have a hearing tomorrow morning. Fannie Mae was arguing, does Brockton, have the right? Meanwhile, that hearing there's a settlement, so that challenge will not happen. But we know that we face more challenges down the road. We know that we may win some of those challenges, but we want to have a plan B. That would be simply to submit exactly the same ordinance as a home rule petition to the state legislature. Such a home rule petition would address any challenges that the bank may have coming forth. And again, thank you.
Thank you. Councilor Falwell.
I apologize. I wasn't here at the last council, so this is a new issue to me. Attorney Flax, if I could ask you a question.
Yes, I'm Martin Flax. I represent various post-foreclosure homeowners and evictions.
All right. What does this suggested home rule petition do that Chapter 186A doesn't do to preserve tenant rights?
The ordinance that was passed by the city of Brockton, it actually protects homeowners, not just tenants.
Okay.
It protects homeowners. So we feel that if it gets challenged, we would like to present it as a home rule petition as a backup plan so that the state might approve the same ordinance that Brockton already approved.
But there are two bills pending in the state legislature now, if I'm correct, one on the House side and one on the Senate side regarding homeowners' Bill of Rights. Am I correct?
I'm not aware of that. I don't know.
But this talks about eviction. I know you're talking about homeowners, but I guess my question is 186A covers tenants, so you're saying this would cover a homeowner whose home is foreclosed?
Yes.
All right, now I have a question on the wording of this, and I'm not an attorney, so just bear with me. Foreclosure sale purchaser shall mean a foreclosing owner as defined herein, or a person or entity that purchases a residential property from a foreclosing owner. So let's assume I live outside Brockton, and there's a piece of property being foreclosed here in the city, and I turn around and I buy it. It's a two-family. So I buy it, I'm going to occupy the first floor, and I want to put my mother and father, who are elderly, on the second floor. If I'm reading this correctly, if that property already had a tenant, I wouldn't meet one of the just cause provisions. Am I right?
I don't know the answer to that. I'm here just to speak on behalf of taking the ordinance that was already passed by the city of Brockton and presenting it to the state for the home rule petition.
The problem I have is I wasn't here. I didn't hear the dialogue, but Attorney Gilday is not here, but the Supreme Judicial Court ruled, and I think it's East Hampton Savings Bank versus the city of Springfield, that foreclosure ordinances were not constitutional. Springfield exceeded its authority. So now I'm concerned, and again, I don't want to go back to what was done in a prior council, but I'm concerned that we're exceeding our authority. And if I'm reading this right, if I'm just the words that are here, there's a listing of eight different things that constitute just cause when you can take a tenant and evict them from a property that's foreclosed. And I don't see the fact that if someone wanted to invest in Brockton and move here and buy a two-family house and move in one floor and put their mother or father in the second floor, that doesn't fit within the just cause provisions, and you wouldn't be able to have the existing tenant leave.
But the ordinance deals with with purchasers at the auction.
Right.
That are, yeah, go ahead.
Through the chair, Councilor Fowle, this is Steve Meacham. He's actually one of the attorneys also that deals with the tenants, and I believe he can, I believe he helped Councilor Dubois with the language in this, so he can explain it better.
I mean, I'm not an attorney, actually. I don't want to make that mistake. But my understanding is that the people that are affected by this ordinance are people who buy at the foreclosure sale auction. That's almost always the bank or a major investor. The person that buys post-auction is not affected by the ordinance. So it simply says there's a state law that protects tenants in foreclosed buildings.
Yeah.
And those tenants have the right of just cause eviction that you're reading. And that was passed unanimously by the state legislature. There is a bill sponsored by Senator Eldridge that would do the same for homeowners, but it hasn't gone through yet. But you know, a home rule petition has a different dynamic than a statewide law. And there are people, presumably, who would say, look, if Brockton wants to do this, then that's great. I don't want to pass it statewide, though. So this could be taken care of if Senator Eldridge's law passed. We wouldn't need it. And we wouldn't need it if our ordinance is upheld. But the thing that would challenge the ordinance would be an understanding that we don't have that authority you mentioned, and that we could be upheld. But if we're not upheld, then the home rule would address that problem that you just raised by the Supreme Court.
Well, but let me go back to my question, reading about just cause. There are certain criteria when you may evict a current tenant if you purchase a foreclosed property. And I don't see in here where you can purchase a property for your own use and for the use of a family member and meet the just cause provisions and have that tenant leave. Am I right?
Well, if you buy after the foreclosure auction, you're not covered by this ordinance.
But what if I buy at a foreclosure auction?
Then you're covered by the ordinance.
So I wouldn't be able to take a tenant who was there and say, I'd like you to leave because I'm moving into the first floor and I'm putting my mother and father in the second floor.
That's my understanding, but I never see, frankly, in all the buildings that we visit, I never see at an auction that somebody wanting to do that buys at auction. It's almost always subsequent to the auction.
That may be, but I have to tell you, and I would say to my colleague, Councilor Barnes, I can't support that. I mean, I really believe in fairness, but I also believe in property rights. And if someone buys a piece of property, even in this country, one person is important. The rights of one individual are important. We've had Supreme Court cases decided on the rights of one individual. And if one individual goes to an auction and buys a foreclosed property and they want to move their family in there, but they can't get the tenant out because it doesn't meet the just cause criteria, that's just patently unfair. That's just not right.
Evicting to move in should be a just cause.
Well, it isn't. I don't see that here. And I, councilors, I always respect however you all vote, but I am not going to vote favorably on this. I think there are too many unanswered questions, and I also think it's a statewide issue. Very respectfully, when you start getting into certain public policy issues, they should be uniform statewide. They really shouldn't be. We don't want 351 cities and towns having different home rule petitions to handle major public policies like foreclosures and tenancy and issues like that. So I respect your work, sir, but the way this is written, I couldn't support it.
I respectfully to you, I would just say that in our negotiations with, and we're talking about major banks here because Massachusetts banks are exempt from the law. So we're talking about Fannie Mae and Bank of America and people like that. And that we have things like this make it much more possible to negotiate before foreclosure to avoid the foreclosure. And even if foreclosure happens, we've been able to get a lot of people their homes back by purchasing the property, the homeowner purchasing back the property themselves. And you never have that period where the building gets boarded up because it's empty. And so it's worked really well to do that. But the only problem now is that it may be challenged by a bank just on the narrow issue of state authority. I'm not sure that the challenge will be upheld. But if it is, that's why we're seeking this law. And if the council in its wisdom felt like you needed to add something to it, then I think that you could add something to it. But
And I guess I would just say in closing, if we were to pass this and we were challenged, we could end up paying $100,000 in legal fees to defend our home rule petition. And I just don't want to get into that position, very respectfully to my colleagues. But thank you very much.
Well, the home rule would prevent the challenge. Yeah.
If I may, through the chair, this is already an order that has been used for the last year or some change. Like Mr. Meacham said, it's targeted really for, you know, some of the big investors, the bigger banks that are coming in, and these people are living here. I can't say for sure, but there's not been an issue where an out-of-town person wants to move into Brockton, sees this home, it's occupied, and they want to do the scenario that you said. It's mostly the investors that want to flip it and go forward and trying to get these people out of here. So this is, I mean, I respect your position on this, but this is already on our books. It's already been approved. So if you want to make some changes to this, it would have to come, I think, at a later time. Like, right now, what we're here for is for these folks for us to approve it, to take it to the home rule, so that's what they would do. It's not about the particulars or the execution of the ordinance in and of itself.
Just as a point of information to the chair, if I could, are we talking about the exchange of email between Attorney Gilday and the city solicitor, where they both said that original ordinance that was adopted should be repealed because it's not legal?
Did I see that email?
We all got it.
Yeah, you did. Yeah, because you answered.
Oh, that's right. Oh, that, okay. There were a lot of a flood of emails.
Are we talking about that same ordinance that they said it should be repealed because it's not legal?
Well, that's their opinion. But I mean, there's still, and there's still some outstanding cases that haven't really decided that yet.
If I understand it correctly, the reason they're saying it may be illegal is because it doesn't have state authority. The home rule is precisely designed to answer that problem.
If it gets challenged, if the challenge is upheld, then that's where.
All right. I think I think we understand where we are.
Okay.
I'd entertain a motion.
Motion to recommend favorably.
Second.
Thank you.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably. All those in favor? All those opposed? Recommend unfavorably to the City Council. Item number 19.
Resolve that the Brockton Water Systems Manager, representative of the Brockton Water Commission, a representative of the Central Plymouth County Water District Commission, Mr. Alex Mansfield, and Ms. Pine Dubois of the Jones River Watershed Association be invited to a meeting of the City Council to discuss issues affecting the quality and quantity of the city's water resources. The address of Jones River Watershed Association is 55 Landing Road, Kingston, Mass. Invited Lawrence Riley, DPW Commissioner, Brian Creedon, Water Systems Manager, Ozzy Jordan, Water Commission, Paul Collis, Commissioner, Central Plymouth County Water District, Jack O'Leary, Commissioner, Central Plymouth County Water District, Alex Mansfield, Ecology Program Director, Jones River Watershed Association, and Pine Dubois, Executive Director, Jones River Watershed Association.
Council Farwell.
Mr. Chairman, I don't see half the people here. I
don't either.
I'm
see
not
the Brockton representatives. I don't see any of the representatives of the.
I'm not quite sure what happened, so I would like to move to postpone this to a FinCom in the call of the chair. You want it July or August? It's
August.
Just a question: have you heard from any of those people, Mr. Riley, or our clerks?
No, I haven't. And good evening, everybody. And Councilor Farwell, what is this all about? We don't.
Well, it's about the sufficiency of the water supply vis-a-vis undergoing an urban redevelopment program downtown, and also the sufficiency of the ability of Aquaria to provide additional water. For example, under the contract, we are now at 3.81 million gallons per day, plus they have to go 700,000 gallons over that. So,
actually, Councilor, the motion is on the table to postpone. So you can have offline, have discussion
okay.
about this.
Yeah, let's do that.
Motion has been made and seconded to postpone to the July. I'm going to recommend the July finance meeting.
July.
All those in favor? All those opposed? Postpone to the July finance meeting. Thank you. We can't talk about it. It's already been
talk about that today.
talk about one other thing?
No, actually, you can't.
Okay.
Sorry, it's... Thank you. You can make the suggestion offline to... Make the suggestion offline to Councilor Farwell, or we can... Okay, thank you. Item number 20.
Resolved to have members of the staff of Brockton 21st Century Corp, along with the Mayor Carpenter, inform the City Council on current projects taking place to promote further economic development, new business, maintaining business, and other outstanding issues being faced by this organization. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, Rob May, Director of Planning, Michael Gallerini, Executive Director of Brockton 21st Century Corp, John Marion, Chairperson Brockton 21st Century Corp, and Matthew Osborne, Treasurer Brockton 21st Century Corp.
Yes.
Councilor Beauregard.
I filed this resolve, and I spoke with the mayor earlier today. He had a previous engagement. Apparently, what's happening here is people weren't getting their mail on time to find out that they were, you know, supposed to be at the meeting this evening. So he asked me to postpone this to the June Finance Committee meeting, and I said that we'd be glad to oblige.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to postpone to the June finance meeting. All those in favor? Opposed? Postpone to June. Item 21.
Resolved to have Matthew Zaylor of the Trinity Financial Corp and any other individual from this company to update the City Council as to the development of a parking garage at the Enterprise Block and any information regarding a restaurant inside this establishment. Invited Matthew Zaylor, Trinity Financial Corp, and or his designee, Robert Malley, Executive Director of Parking Authority.
And I know Mr. Zaylor did contact me, and he only received his mail. He was on vacation last week.
Thank you, yes, and he asked me to postpone it to the June Finance Committee meeting.
Second.
Thank you.
Motion made and seconded to postpone to the June Finance meeting. All those in favor? Opposed? Sent to the June Finance meeting. Item 22.
Resolved to invite George Durante the new fellow hired through Mass Development to work on downtown economic projects to learn more about the transformative development initiative and expected results. You were requested to invite Mr. Durante, TDI fellow, Director of Planning, and Robert Jenkins from the BRA on this matter. Invited George Durante, hired through Mass Development, Robert May, Director of Planning, Robert Jenkins, Executive Director of the BRA.
Councilor Beauregard, I think we got this one.
Yes, thank you. Yes, I filed this resolve, and fortunately, Mr. George Durante is here this evening, and he also is here with the Director of Planning, Rob May. Robert Jenkins, Director of Brockton Redevelopment Authority, had told me that he received his mailing, and he thought he might be able to come in later this evening.
He was going to try to get here, but he may not be. But
thank you.
Good evening, Mr. Is it Durant or Durante?
It's Durante.
Loved your grandfather.
Yeah, I wish there was some relation. So, good evening, Mr. Chairman and City Council. It's a pleasure to meet you. Happy to answer any questions that you have.
Well, if I could,
Beauregard.
Mr. Chair, thank you again for coming this evening. And what's going on here? The lie. No, the reason I contacted you this evening to come this evening is to because you've been recently appointed to this position, and we've never had someone in a position like yours in our city, and we were excited about what your responsibilities would include, any kind of projects that you'd be working on, and to be proactive instead of reactive and be aware of what's going on, how we can work together to see a better downtown.
Yeah. I'm sure you're aware, the TDI...
Could pull that podium back. Turn that up a little, push it up, might stop that. Thank you. Thank you.
So, as I'm sure many of you are aware, the TDI initiative has been, the planning process for it has been going on for the past year plus, and now we are starting to approach the implementation phase, and this is where I come in. The Downtown Brockton Action Strategy Plan, that is my guiding book, essentially, you could say, and my primary goal and my primary focus is just to look at the downtown and implement that plan along with the partnership, which includes the city, Brockton 21st Century Corporation, Trinity, and I would say the Brockton Redevelopment Authority, though not officially a partner at this time, we expect them to be. I'm really looking forward to my time here in Brockton. I'm here for 3 years. And we're certainly going to make some things happen.
Oh, okay, if I can continue here?
Yes. So Mr. May actually presented a good point. I am an employee of Mass Development, I am really in a facilitator role and an implementation technical assistance role. Just to give you a brief background on the TDI initiative, it is for gateway cities. It's an urban revitalization initiative that is under the state, under the Commonwealth. And we offer technical assistance within the TDI district, as well as equity investment opportunities from Mass Development and business development programming.
Okay, I'm sorry if
you
I
still
could
have
continue.
The floor,
yes,
Beauregard.
Thank you, and I will defer to my colleagues momentarily. I just wanted to cover a couple of things here. What we want, you know, people understand. Certainly, we have the budget hearings next week, so they wanted to make sure that people understood that you were not being paid out of the city's budget. So that was one. And two, to also highlight maybe your experience where you've done something else like this in a gateway community, so that we can look forward to the positive results that took place somewhere else taking place here.
Yeah, sure. So, yes, as I said, I am a Mass Development employee, so there isn't any direct funding coming out of the city budget to fund my salary. Prior to working here, I was with the Executive Office of Housing and Economic Development, where I primarily focused on the MassWorks program, as well as Urban Agenda and Community Compacts. And I was in a very similar role up in the city of Nashua, New Hampshire, which I think we could all consider what would be a gateway city if it was in Massachusetts, where much of my work was focused on downtown revitalization, working with businesses, working with developers to really revitalize that area.
Okay, I'm sorry. Where did you leave this? I mean, you started out with Nashua, maybe the downtown looking rather unfavorable, and did you turn this around? What can people, you know, expect from all this? And I also had another question.
Yeah. Sure. I think, you know, what we're really going to try and do, and this is myself and the partnership, as well as all the stakeholders in downtown, is to bring this Brockton downtown action strategy to fruition and really achieve a lot of the results that are laid out in that. 3 years is not a long time, but it's enough time to hopefully get a lot of these things started. So I'm going to do the very best I can to make this happen.
Okay, my other question, if I can. Sir, we had talked about, we ran into each other at Enzo Flats reception. Mm-hmm. And over here I have some information on community gardening and overview and urban agriculture. And since you're focusing on downtown, one of the maps we received here, rather disheartening here, showed us the food desert, and it was the immediate area of the downtown and all these areas where we're not seeing the opportunity for nutritious food, or there's an insufficient amount for the individuals residing in that area. And I was hoping you could highlight that, and that's why I asked you to highlight a little bit about Nashua. Did they get urban gardening? Did they do rooftop gardening? Did they take a dilapidated building and turn it into a performing arts center? Different things on that idea. Thank you.
Yeah, so Vicente's, I think, helps mitigate some of that. But in terms of Nashua, we really didn't focus on urban agriculture or rooftop gardening. However, I did work with a startup social enterprise called Sustainability Guild, which was based in Dorchester. And one of the things that we focused on was taking vacant and blighted lots and providing temporary uses for them, one of which was urban agriculture and gardening, green roofs and arts and things like that. So it's certainly something I've dealt with in the past.
Thank you, and I'll defer to my colleagues, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. Anybody else?
I just had one quick question.
Councilor Sullivan.
First of all, thank you for being here. Welcome to Brockton, and I expect in the next 3 years you're going to accomplish some great things. I only have one question. Do you have space here in Mr. May's office? Is that where you're located?
No, I'm actually located at 60 School Street.
Oh, you are?
And I'm on the second floor next to the chamber. So
okay.
If you ever need me, I've got a little office there.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you.
You're welcome. Thank you very much.
Mr.
If you want to drag it out, go ahead.
I want to drag it out. No, because as part of the Downtown Action Strategy, the farmers market plays an important role in a placemaking activity. And I know Councilor Beauregard and I have talked about it quite a bit. We do have a challenge going on right now to double the SNAP benefits. So if you go to the farmers market, BrocktonFarmersMarket.com page or our Facebook page, there are links that you can help Brockton's neediest families, particularly, you know, we have a large population downtown, of extending the SNAP benefits at the farmers market. So for every $10 they pay, they get an extra $10 in benefits.
And what's the, is that the City of Brockton Facebook page? Or?
It's the farmers market Facebook page, but you can find it through the City of Brockton's Facebook page.
Thank you. Anyone else? Make a motion?
Yes, I make a motion to move this favorably.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to recommend favorably full City Council. All those in favor? Opposed? Recommended favorably. Thank you. Good luck, Mr. Durante. Item 23.
Resolved that the Mayor, Superintendent of Buildings, City Solicitor, City Planner, and Paul McLally to appear before a committee of this Council to discuss the status of ownership of the property located at 121 Main Street. Invited Honorable Mayor Bill Carpenter, James Casseri, Superintendent of Buildings, Philip Nazarella, City Solicitor, Rob May, Director of Planning, and Paul Mullally, Contractor Brockton Main Street Improvement LLC.
Councilor Barnes.
Thank you. Councilors, I brought this forward before and again, and over the weekend I had lengthy conversations with Mr. Mullally and also our City Solicitor, and they have actually conversed. So they are working on an issue. There was a miscommunication originally, but we are all very confident that this is going to be resolved and that property will have the attention that it deserves very, very soon. So I'm going to table this this issue for months and months or
second.
However long it happens.
Motion made and
table.
Motion made and seconded to table this item. All those in favor? Opposed? It is tabled.
Thank you,
Councilors. Thank you. Councilors, before we move on, I think we'd be remiss if we didn't make note of the fact that just the other night, even though we didn't have a meeting, Councilor Razak had a birthday, so happy birthday, Councilor Razak.
Hey.
And I would like to mention
how old is she?
That's not a question we ask, Councilor Monahan. She's old enough to get elected, but I believe her and Councilor Lally went to school together, so.
Yes.
Yeah, reform school.
I'd also be remiss in saying that the weather yesterday did not cooperate, but there was a wonderful ceremony inside the War Memorial Building to commemorate Memorial Day, and I, on behalf of the council, want to thank our two veterans on the council, Councilor Studensky and Councilor Rodriguez, for their service in the past, and I thank them. And also, don't leave tonight. You have your school department budget book. Was at your seat tonight? Your full budget book is out back. Monday evening at 6:30, we will start. I believe you have a new schedule.
Yes.
That oftentimes has some changes in there. The police will be moved to Wednesday night. Chief Crowley was busy on Monday night. I'll give my usual warning that I've given before when I do council, do finance. We're not here to tell every department head they've done a great job. We can just give them that due as a group. Try not to be redundant. It gets very long, these meetings, especially for you new councilors, when you have valid questions. And for you new members, although I'm sure the former mayor, he's very aware of this, we can only cut the budget, and we can only cut it by groupings, not by line items. So try to be prepared and try not to be redundant on Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday, and we'll try to get you out of here. And Councilor Monahan, you're in charge of food for Monday night.
What else is new?
Just one last item, Councilor Fowle.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, just a moment of personal privilege.
You may.
One of the greatest joys of being a parent is that you can embarrass your children. So I would like to wish my son Winthrop III a happy 37th birthday tomorrow.
And you didn't think naming him Winthrop III wasn't embarrassing enough?
I figured if I have to carry that name, he can do the same thing. So.
Well, in that case, I would also like to take a moment of personal privilege and wish my sister Peggy a happy birthday today. I won't say what year. So happy birthday, and we're adjourned.